everyone. My name is Amelia, and I'm from the high school group. This year, we have been discussing virtues and ethics and how we should be using and thinking about them in our everyday lives. To keep this in mind, we usually read a quote from Buddha. If you would all now look in your programs and join me in saying his quote. The thought manifests as word, the word manifests as deed, the deed develops into habit, the habit hardens into character, so watch the thought and its ways with care, and let it spring from love born out of all beings, as the shadow follows the body, as we think, so we become. Thank you.
I'm Josie Messersmith. Virtue ethics is a theory that emphasizes using character and virtue in moral dilemmas. Instead of trying to, say, create the greatest good for the greatest amount of people, like utilitarianists would, a virtue ethicist would want to act in the way that is based in their virtues, like honesty, respect, bravery, kindness, and many more. When we first started talking about virtue ethics in our class, I have to be honest, I thought it was a little bit basic. Now, to understand this, last year we would have these really complex, abstract discussions about philosophy, and we covered all the major concepts like, do we have free will? Is there meaning in life? And we would talk about Plato and Socrates, and Derek would bring in these like giant books that had like, half the words were five syllables, and it was super complex and hard to understand. And in comparison, talking about how to be honest and kind seemed a little bit elementary. I thought that I had internalized these virtues and had figured out the complexities and subtleties of them, but as the year went on and through our discussions of these values, I realized how insanely difficult it is to be conscious of your actions and make the virtuous choice. We talked about different philosophers' ideas like Aristotle's and their thoughts on virtue ethics, and then created our own opinions and tried to apply them to our life. And even though I thought I knew how to be kind, suddenly now that I was thinking about it during my day-to-day life, always doing the kind thing seemed much less obvious and much harder than I thought it would be. We would end class on Sundays, and I would realize all the changes I can make in my life to get closer to having the character that I wanted to see in myself and wanted to see in others. Sundays were a time to analyze your actions and think about how to live your life more in tune with your values. We would share our experiences, showing that everybody at one point struggles with being ethical. But ignorance is bliss, and being aware that you aren't always a good person can be unpleasant and requires putting energy into self-improvement and self-awareness. Having virtue isn't as intuitive as I thought it was, which is why talking about virtue ethics is so important. To understand and be conscious of your actions allows for more purposeful interactions and creates a concept of who you want to be in life. Reflecting back on this year, I've realized that I've been more aware of my interactions and my thoughts than ever before, and that it is not elementary to struggle with how to live life, proud of your actions, and how to use basic virtues to navigate through the world. If anything, it's a struggle that is never ending and requires more thought than most major philosophical concepts. In this class, we debated about virtue ethics and collectively tried to figure out our opinions. My peers today will talk about their experiences, sharing what we think that we figured out. Thank you.
truth is, I am a toy that people enjoy to all the tricks. Don't work anymore, then they're bored of me. I know that it's exciting running through the night, but every perfect summer is eating me alive until you're gone. Better on my own, they say. You're a little much for me. You're a liability. You're a little much for me. Slowly pull back, make other plans. I understand, I'm a liability. Get you wild, make you leave. I'm a little much for you. Na na na.
Hi, my name is Victoria Giersdorf, and I am here to talk to you about virtue ethics and animals. Or more specifically, the virtue ethics of compassion, charity, kindness, and respect, and how we can apply them to animals. But first, I want to ask you a question. What if we changed the first principle from the inherent worth and dignity of every person to the inherent worth and dignity of every being? Now, what would this change imply? Well, I think it would allow us to change our perspective on how we view animals as a whole and how we behave towards them. Pretty much everyone here can agree that animals are pretty great. They are beautiful, they can perform amazing feats, they help the environment, they feed us, and can even provide emotional and physical support in our daily lives. Plus, who wouldn't like to hug a fluffy animal? However, in order for us to follow this principle, we need to do several things. First, we need to learn how to apply the virtue ethic of respect to animals, whether they be wild or domesticated. In order to fully respect animals, we have to learn and understand more about them, specifically how to behave around animals in order to make ourselves and the animal more comfortable and to make human and animal interactions more safe. Because nothing's really fun about getting a face full of teeth. If we want an animal to like us, for example, especially one that we interact with on a daily basis, we need to know how to respect their personal space and to know what makes them feel threatened. Second, we must apply the virtue ethic of compassion to animals, specifically with the way we treat them. This should be pretty simple. Be kind to them, treat them as you would want to be treated, not force them to live in horrible conditions. But unfortunately, it's not that simple. Third, we must apply the virtue ethic of charity by considering that if we believe that everything or every being has worth and dignity, then why is it so hard for us to save animals from extinction and habitat loss? If we truly believe that every being has worth, then we need to step up with the prevention of extinction of animals all around the world, because we need these animals and they need us to save them. So let me ask you again, what if we change the first principle from the inherent worth and dignity of every person to the inherent worth and dignity of every being?
Oh, Welcome. We're so happy you could join us today for the high school service. And we as a group would love to get to know the rest of the congregation better, especially as some of us graduate and bridge from high schoolers to young adults. If you're visiting us for the first time today, we hope you stop by the welcome table so we can get to know each other a little better. If you wish to become more involved with our church community, stop by the Congressional Life table for information about service opportunities, social activities, and upcoming events. Both will be in Elliott Hall during the coffee hour following the service. And now for a few quick announcements. First is the UU orientation with Reverend Tom and Reverend Monica, which will be held Monday, March 19th from 7 to 9 p.m. in Elliott Hall. This is the last orientation of the year, and if you are new to our congregation, are interested in becoming a member, or want to refresh your basic understanding of being a UU, you're invited. Next is the child dedication service on Sunday, March 25th. During the 9 and 11 a.m. services, visit the RE table during coffee hour in Elliott Hall for more information. Next is the social justice poster party on Thursday, March 22nd in Elliott Hall from 6 to 8 p.m. in preparation for the March for Our Lives the following Saturday. Many of us youth will be there to decorate signs for the march. Feel free to bring poster board, markers, glitter, and other supplies. Finally is the actual March for Our Lives on Saturday, March 24th at 11 a.m., starting from West High School and marching to a rally at the Capitol. In light of the recent Parkland massacre and many more school shootings this year, taking a stand on gun violence in this country is more important than ever. This is an issue that's especially important to us as youth who are literally being killed in our own classrooms, so many, if not all of us, will be there to march in support of gun legislation. We'd love it if we had a strong UU presence from as many of you as possible, too. That's all for announcements, and if you would like more information, please reference your order of service. The offering will now be gratefully received. Please take this time to greet your neighbor, and in keeping with the theme of this service, perhaps tell them about one of your favorite virtues and why it's important to you.
This is Just to Say by William Carlos Williams. I've eaten the plums that were in the icebox and which you were probably saving for breakfast. Forgive me, they were so delicious, so sweet, and so cold. Variations of This is Just to Say by Kenneth Coach. I chopped down the house that you had been saving to live in next summer. I am sorry, but it was morning and I had nothing to do, and its wooden beams were so inviting. We laughed at the hollyhocks together, and then I sprayed them with lye. Forgive me, I simply do not know what I am doing. I gave away the money that you had been saving to live on for the next 10 years. The man who asked for it was shabby, and the firm March wind on the porch was so juicy and cold. Last evening, we went dancing, and I broke your leg. Forgive me, I was clumsy, and I wanted you here in the wards, where I am the doctor. Hi, my name is Charlie, and I'm going to be talking about honesty. With honesty, there can definitely be too much of a good thing. Honesty can be used to express yourself by being honest about yourself, what you need, what you can offer, and so on. You can positively use honesty every day. But in the poem, This is Just to Say, the speaker uses honesty in a very passive-aggressive way to gloat about something that they did just to spite someone else. almost like I was being honest. Honesty is a good thing. There is a very fine line between positive honesty and negative honesty, and I think that it is for each person to find out for themselves how they can use honesty in a positive way.
I am Adeline Black, and this is Ethics as it Relates to the Environments Around Us. We humans have an unavoidable relationship with the animal kingdom and the rest of the planet, mostly because we too are animals, also because of our earth-altering superpowers. Awareness of this relationship comes in many forms. Some, let us call them carnivores, see dominion as perfectly acceptable option. I like meat, so bugger the consequences. Others see any consumption of animals or fruits of their labors as reprehensible, vegan, vegetarian, other variations on that theme. Until we learn to incorporate chlorophyll into our cellular makeup, we will be consuming other living things to keep ourselves ticking. Not to mention the logistical issue of how to photosynthesize sufficient for our mass and energy needs on a tiny surface, even in the tiniest of bikinis, we have nothing like the required surface area. Sci-fi aside, how to balance the requirements of my life with the requirements of others' lives. I like to give plants and animals equal billing, along with fungi, smut molds, water bears, and all the others that others that share the tree of life. Might be able to do without mosquitoes, but even parasites have a place. Our immune system can go a little bit bonkers without them. So there are systems of life, ecosystems, large and small, that deserve attention and defense and protection and admiration. How to interact with them all when we have, evolutionarily speaking, an oversized influence. I feel driven to proceed with a willingness to see how my actions affect ecosystems around me, and a willingness to change my behavior, exerting a little effort so that I do not waste resources, noticing when I have taken more than I need. Is the world trying to recover from my having been through, or are things running more smoothly? I don't object to predators, myself included. Ecosystems need predators. Kestrels, sharpshin hawks, and cooper hawks all frequent my backyard, and hundreds of sparrows. When one of those birds of prey catches a sparrow, I celebrate. First of all, it's fun to watch a bird of prey in action. Second, without the predators, the sparrows would exhaust their food supply, not good for the ecosystem. As a life form with excessive amounts of power, I must tread carefully. I can exert influence over a huge swath of life without ever feeling the effects myself. Buffered from the natural consequences of my actions, I must be aware and act accordingly. I will not wait to be forced to share the planet equitably.
Hi, my name is Liam Connor, and today I would like to talk to you about a virtue that is often discussed but rarely defined, bravery. Our class spent many lessons discussing the virtue of bravery, but before I tell you what we learned, it's important to have background on what virtues are. Aristotle, a Greek philosopher living in 3rd century BC, laid out a system of ethics which we studied this year. Briefly put, virtue ethics focuses on character of the person faced with a tough decision and how the decision will define them. It can be broken down into different virtues. And each of these virtues you can have too much of and too little of. In the case of bravery, too much is recklessness and too little bravery is cowardice. Bravery is the virtue of risking something of your own for something you believe, whether that is charging into battle for your country or standing up to your awful boss about their latest draconian policy. When we look through history, it is littered with examples. When Galileo challenged the orthodoxy of the church based on his own experimentation, that was bravery. And when Rosa Parks refused to kneel to segregation and sit in the back of the bus, that was bravery. And even closer to our own lives, when Tim D. Christopher bid on land he couldn't pay for, sacrificing his own freedoms for our earth, our seventh principle, that was bravery. But we don't need to look through the history textbooks to find examples of bravery. Instead, we could simply look to each other. Aristotle believed that in order to become more virtuous, we should find people in our lives who exemplify the virtue and try and follow in their footsteps. I only need to look to my friends who organized our school's March for Our Lives walkout to see courage in action. It is important to bring bravery into our own lives. I would like to ask everyone in this congregation to be more conscientious in our own lives of courage and to focus on standing up for what we believe. Thank you.
Thank you. Hello? All right, cool. Hey, y'all. For those who don't know me, my name is Tyler Hauser. I go to the RE High School group. I'm supposed to give some closing words, so here they are. My opinion may be a little bit biased, but I think that went really well. That's just me, though. But yeah, I want to thank you guys for all coming to this service, letting us tell you and talk about our opinions and what we think virtue ethics are. So yeah, thank you guys.
If we haven't met, I'm the Reverend Monica Dobbins. I'm the assistant minister of this congregation, and I really want to thank each and every one of you for coming out today to hear these youth talk about their faith, express their artistic abilities, and enlighten all of us. So can we give them one more round of applause? You did a wonderful job. What you've heard today is just a slice of what they've done this year and what they will continue to do as the year goes on. They are collecting feminine products for the Road Home, is that right? Yeah. They're collecting feminine products for unhoused women at the Road Home shelter. And they're also going to be visiting Topaz down in southern Utah to learn about the internment camp that was there and to collect actual topaz on Topaz Mountain. That's so cool. Before I let you go for coffee, none of this would have happened without the help of four very important people, our high school teachers, Dot Verbrugge, Rob Richardson, Derek Giersdorf, and Cooper. Let's give them some love. And now, since you have a little bit longer coffee break, I invite you to continue the conversation about your virtue ethics and how they matter in your life. Let's enjoy each other's company right now.